go ahead with it. Okay, all right. So we're good to go here. Welcome everyone to another webinar of EDIST. And just to have a recap, we've done a bunch of webinars. We've just touched 4,000 subscribers. So thanks everybody who subscribed, who has yet not subscribed. Just click the subscribe button. You will get a lot of more information about what are all of the other webinars that we're going to do. Before I begin the actual webinar, just want to tell you that you just need to type on the right hand side on the chat if you need any help. So if you need any help, just type on the right hand side on the chat and we are more than happy to help you out over there. Our team is online. They will answer you right away. And if you don't get your answer right now, I will look at your questions towards the end of the session as well. So that's what we are going to do. And so before I start, just to tell you about this new Python course that we have launched. We are covering both introduction as well as advanced in this course. So we are covering both intro concepts as well as advanced concepts in this course. And we're going to do a mini Python project in just about 20 minutes right now. So we're going to do about like a mini Python project in just 20 minutes to show you how easy it is to actually do Python and to pick up a project. So and see, I see a lot of people already online putting on the chat. So if anybody has any questions, just keep typing away and we are there for you, right? So yes, just coming to Python, before I start about Python and talk about the mini project, let me tell you a little bit more about what are the kind of things that you can do in Python. So if you are an intro student or if you're someone who doesn't know any programming at all, let me tell you that there are a lot of things you can do in Python. One of the things that you could do is you can do web development. You can actually pick up machine learning when you want to do Python. You can actually do data analytics, game development. There is so much scope to do all of these things. You can do any of the things that are mentioned over here. So that's data analytics, game development, machine learning, web development, and so on. But the beauty of Python actually is that you get to do all of this by learning from scratch. You don't really need to spend a lot of time understanding the concepts because the syntax of Python is so simple that you can just pick it up really easily, like pick up the concepts very, very quickly. So it's a very, very easy language. You will be able to understand all of these concepts very easily because Python is structured like that. That's why so many beginners prefer to use Python. So the learning step, the starting block for everybody is that you might want to get into any of these careers. So that's like web development, machine learning, whichever one you want. And these are like really hot careers in the market right now. You are going to get really good packages and salaries if you do any of these fields. But to start with, you need to have the basics and fundamentals of Python correctly. So a lot of students get into this idea that they will directly go into machine learning, or I'll directly go into game development, or you know, directly go into web development. Well, the problem with that is if your structural fundamentals are not correct, then you're not going to get into the these careers. You will just have a certificate, but you're not going to get a job. At EDIST, what we specialize in is we help you learn programming first and foremost. So whatever programming that we teach you, you'll be able to learn not only in Python, but you can transport that programming into any other programming language. And with those programming fundamentals, any of these careers becomes really easy for you to do. So any of the careers that you see over here, web development, machine learning, data analytics, game development, or even more in Python, it becomes easy to go for these careers because your fundamentals are really correct. All right. So that's why we have chosen Python, because of all of these different career choices that you can make. If you are somebody who's, you know, graduating, already graduated, thinking about should I learn Java, Selenium, machine learning, AI, first learn programming. And my humble suggestion is take up Python, easier to pick up early on, and then you can branch into any of these careers that you see over here on the slide. And that's why it's not just you, you'll be joining all the other people who have chosen Python, making it the most popular programming language. Python has become so popular, and that's why you get all of these careers in Python, because everybody is coding on Python these days. So if you choose Python, you will be joining the most popular language, which means that if you are in the most popular language, you are going to get more job opportunities. the different languages have different uses. Python has the use cases of web development, machine learning. Java has for Android, financial applications, and so on. But choosing Python in 2019 is a great, great choice. You will not only learn programming, but you will also learn web development and AI and all of these things to get a really great career. So this was a little bit of introduction for all of you who is joining us first time for our Python series. You know, for the rest of the students who've already been there for the Python series, just wait about 2 more minutes and I will dive right into the mini project that we're going to do. All right. So just a recap of some of the things that we covered recently in the previous Python series, just to show you again how easy Python can be. Let me show you how you can actually do a very simple hello world in Python. So in Python, a hello world is written like this, and this is just a recap, so I'm not going to like type it out and actually do it, but if you check over here, this simple hello world print statement will actually print this output. It's as simple as that. If you've done Java or C++, you will remember that it's very, very big syntax over there. You have to write a lot of lines, but in Python, this is how simply you can do it. So we are going to use this concept today for our password generation. And let me share another concept with you to understand. So let's say this, we saw that if you print hello world, if you type print hello world, it will print hello world. But if I do this, if I create a new variable called my word and I add these two strings, that is the string edist and the string cool, then I print that string, I'm going to get edist cool as the output. So just repeating, you can add two strings, those two strings will become one string, and that one string can be printed out like this. Now this will seem very obvious to many of you, especially those of you who've attended the previous Python sessions, but don't worry, it's just these one or two simple concepts that we are going to use to do our mini project for the day. And so what is our mini project for the day? As you might have seen, the mini project for the day is we are going to create a password generator. So we're going to do a password generator today. That is, you just call that function, and I'll tell you what a function is, don't worry. But you call some code, you'll write some code, and that code is going to generate a password for you, right? And this is going to be really cool because the password can be tweaked to be very strong, very weak. It can be tweaked to make it more rememberable, less rememberable, whatever. But the basic block of it is understanding how do you actually create a password. So let's get right down to it. When we're talking about a password generator, what we have is a set of rules that we have to follow. So if ever you have gone on to a website and try to create an email ID and a password, you will have come across this situation where they say, no, your password is not correct. Your password needs to have a minimum of 8 characters. There has to be at least one uppercase character, one lowercase, one number, and one special character. All of these have to be there. So now that we are given these requirements, and I'm sure any of you who tried making a password online will remember that, you know, you'll start thinking, oh, how should I do if you can't randomly generate all of these because you're not a good random number generator. So you keep thinking, oh, how do you generate this password? Well, we are going to use Python to figure out if we'll just write a line of code that anytime we execute those codes, it's going to generate this password for us that follows and satisfies all of these conditions that we want. So that's the problem statement over here. Let's look at some examples of such passwords. So let's say I look at, you know, this password over here that we've just randomly generated. So this password, 12A!UOP7, is this a valid password as per our requirements? Well, there must be at least 8 characters. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So there is 8 characters. Yes. It has to have at least one uppercase character. Yes, A is there, capital A. At least one lowercase. We have 3 lowercase. Very good. At least one number. Yes, we have 3 numbers. At least one special character. Yes, there's an exclamation mark. So this password passes all our test cases. That is, it meets our requirements. But let's look at this password over here, which we have. It does have a number, it does have an uppercase, it does have a lowercase, it also has an exclamation, which is a special character, but it is less than 8 characters. So it is less than 8 characters, which means it is wrong. It is not a valid password. So we have to figure out how we can generate more passwords like these. We have to figure out how to generate passwords like these and not passwords like these, right? So how do we go about doing this? Well, for any programming question, any project, anything related to coding, your idea should always be to take it step by step. Don't start thinking about, I will use this library, I will use this function in Python. Don't think about all of that. What we'll do is first write the building blocks, right? What are some of the things that we need to have in order to generate this password? Okay, so let's write down those building blocks. In my view, the building blocks would look something like this. We need to have one uppercase character, at least one. So let's, list down all the uppercases and let's choose randomly. Similarly, we need to have at least one number. So let's list down all the numbers and choose one of them randomly, and the lower case, and we'll choose one of them randomly. So what's going to happen is we first build a list of all of the valid characters that we need, and we'll choose randomly from them. Why are we choosing randomly? We could have just chosen any character at any time. Is another requirement of the password generator is it should generate a unique password every time. Imagine every time you're generating the same password, it's easy to crack, no? It's not that difficult to crack. So we want to generate a unique password every time if we have a list of uppercase characters. So let's say we decide that we are going to choose an uppercase character from A, B, or C. That's it, three. But we need to have this list. Then we'll randomly choose one of them, but we need to have this list. Similarly, all the numbers, let's put them in one list. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, and then we'll choose them randomly. Similarly, a lowercase character, and also we'll need special characters. So we'll put things like exclamation and what you could say is hash. So we'll put a hash. So these kind of characters, special characters, we'll create another list. So once we'll have these lists, what are we going to do? We are going to choose one of them randomly. Maybe more, but we're going to choose one of them randomly at least. So now what we have is we have two concepts that we need to figure out in Python. One is how do we store a list of things together? And secondly, how do we choose things randomly? And here is where again I want to show you the simplicity of Python, that writing this isn't really that difficult. In fact, when I start writing the solution, you will see that it's very much like English. It's like writing a lot of English. Okay, so the way you store a list in Python, that is, you just want to store a list of things. In this case, our list would be a list of uppercase characters. So we want to store a list of things. The syntax for doing that in Python is something like this. If you have a list of lowercase characters, so it's going to be like lower underscore case A, B, C, where each of A and B and C are strings in themselves. If you remember from our previous session, a string is nothing but a text object that we just want to store the text together. This uppercase list is going to have all of the uppercase alphabets. Similarly, we could define a numbers is equal to, let's say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on, right? And even more numbers if we want, and special characters we could say are equal to exclamation, and we have over here let's hash. So we can just define these lists, and Python will clearly understand as soon as it sees these square brackets. So as soon as it sees the square brackets, Python understands that okay, this is a list of things together. So just over here, just to take a pause, I see a lot of new students have just joined in. So just to recap, what we are doing today is we're doing a mini project. We are going to use Python, and we're going to use Python so simply that you will feel like, ah, even I can learn this. So we're just going to use a simple Python script to generate a password. This password has to follow certain rules. That is, the password has to have minimum one character that is uppercase, one character that is lowercase, one character which is a number, and one character which is a special character. And every time we run this script, it should generate a new password. The only concepts that we need to know to do this password generator is the concept of lists. How do we store strings in a list, or how do we make a list of things? And we just saw that you just use this syntax, that is the square bracket syntax, and you can see how you can actually store as a list. You also need to know the concept of printing together. So as we saw earlier, if we have a variable called my word, which is equal to edist plus cool, with edist and cool both being a string or a text file, sorry, a string format or a text format, then when we print my word, it prints out edist cool. So with these two concepts and one more concept that we're going to teach, we will be able to generate a password. This concept of printing by combining, this concept of lists, so we just generated a list, and we need to choose randomly from this list. How do we choose randomly from this list? Well, Python also offers us a way of choosing a random object from the list. And the way you can do that is, you need to import something called random. So this is a random library. Just remember that import random will help us use the random functions. That's all you need to know. So we have this thing called import random. If you do random.choice list name, which is nothing but if you give the name of the list, let's say over here we defined lower underscore case. If you do random.choice lower underscore case, it will give you in return one alphabet. That is a lowercase alphabet. That is a part of this list. That's all. So remembering this syntax is enough for us to understand how to choose randomly from a list. That's all. So let's see how we can actually apply this and how we can actually use this in our password generator. These were three concepts that we needed to use. And I hope you all understood these three concepts. If you have not, just put it on the chat. I will cover them towards the end of the session. But the three concepts are, how do you choose randomly from a list? How do you define a list? And how do you print by combining few words together? With that, let's try to implement our own password generator. All right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up this password generator question, which is available on the Edis platform. And let me show you how you can reach that thing. So if you go to the link mentioned below, So if you go to the link mentioned below over here, which says bit.ly/edist_python, you would reach a page like this. So the moment you go into this link, bit.ly/edist_python, you reach a page like this, right? So you'll reach a page like this, which will show you a video and it will show you a lot of other things on the platform. And what you can do is you can click this apply now button and try out one free module. So this is the Python course that we're running, and you can just click apply now and get one free module. And that one free module contains this password generator question. So let me just open that. After you click this apply now and log in, what you're going to see is something like this. You're going to see this entire Python intro plus advanced course. I'm just opening that for you. So this is what you get to see. And in this Python Intro Plus Advanced, this one free module will be unlocked free of cost for you. You just need to go. It's completely free. You go there and you will see this password generator challenge. So I'm going to open this challenge and then I'm going to do this for you, right? So the entire question for the password generator is mentioned over here. We have to implement our own password generator, which must contain at least one special characters. These are the special characters it must contain: one uppercase, one lowercase, one numeric case. Exactly what we have been discussing so far. So let's go ahead and actually write down our own password generator. This is some example code that has already been written. Let us remove that. Because let's see, if we keep our password as sample, what happens? Let us run it. It's wrong because it doesn't have an uppercase or a lowercase or anything. But when we run it, what is it that we get? Our output is this. Your code is not generating unique passwords. So as you can see, password, all the three passwords that we generated from this were a password called sample. The reason for that is it's always sample. We are not doing anything, but we should be generating a unique password every time. Number one. Number two, it has to follow certain criteria. So let's say, for example, let's start coding up our password thing. And the way we're going to do that is, we are going to define what are the characters that we're going to choose from. So we're going to choose, say, lower characters is equal to, we'll define a list. We're going to choose either one of these lower characters, right? B, C, D, and E. So let's choose from one of these lower characters. Yep. Let us choose from one of these upper characters. Okay. And B, C, D, and E. So we're going to choose, and it's your choice. You can keep actually up to all 26 characters and it will still work. But just as an example, I'm going to choose any one of these characters. So we're going to do this: lower characters, upper characters. We need some special characters as well. So special chars is equal to, what do we have here? What are some of the special characters that we should use? Should use and, exclamation, asterisk and a comma. So let us just use that. Say and exclamation and let's say asterisk. These are some of the things that we're going to choose for special characters. What else should it have? We covered our special character, uppercase, lowercase, one numeric character. So let's take the numeric characters as numeric chars is equal to what we have here is 1, 2, 3, 4 and let's say 5, right? That's what we're going to do. All right, so we have these lower characters to choose from, some upper characters to choose from, some special characters to choose from, some numeric characters to choose from. Now let's build our password. Password is equal to, we're going to choose some of the words and we're going to add them. This is where the adding concept comes, where we're going to choose a word, choose a character, and we're just going to add all of them together. So how are we going to add them or choose them? If you remember, we're going to do random.choice. When we do random.choice, it's going to, at random, pick a character from this list. So we did random.choice lower chars plus random.choice upper chars plus random.second. Okay, let me just scroll down so that you can see, right? So we have over here random.choice, what is the other ones? Special chars. Right, and random dot choice upper chars, right? Oh, we already have upper chars. How about numeric chars? So it's going to choose one character randomly from lower characters, one from upper characters, one from special characters, and one from numeric characters. It's going to take that and it's going to return the password. Now this is just four characters. Is four characters enough? Because our question says it should have eight characters. Let's run this and see whether it's okay or not. Let me click run and it says generated password, it generated some password here, has less than 8 characters. So I can't get away with less than 8 characters. I need to have a minimum of 8 characters. What is one thing we can do over here? One of the easy things we can do is, currently our password has 4 characters. To make it 8 characters, all we need to do is just do password. We can just add password to itself. It will just duplicate the password and it will give us some answer, which will be 8 characters. And each that 8 characters has a lowercase, has an uppercase, has a special character, and also has a numeric character. So let's see if this works out. It does. It passes all of the test cases. Great. Now you might be thinking, well, it would have passed anyways. So let's try to remove the lower characters from here. Let's say if we remove the lower characters and see if does our password still work. So now we have 3 characters in this password. We're going to add it 3 times so that we have 9 characters. Let's see if it still works. No, it says we have no lower character. Notice that it's printing 3 times, but it has no lower character. So at this point, this isn't working well. What we should ideally be doing is we need a lower characters. So let's bring that back again. We need a lower characters, we need a and we need this to be 8 characters. Now remember, this password generator says that it has to be at least 8 characters, but it could very well be 24 characters, 30 characters, 40 characters. So to the point where if I just do something like this, right, so it's about 4 times, this should still work because we needed at least 8 characters, right? And yes, it is, it still works even if I do about 4 times. Now, is this a strong password? No, it's not a very strong password, but it works for our test case. Let's see if this works for all of the test cases that we have. If you click submit, it does. It works actually for all of the test cases we have, and we passed all the test cases, and great, we've generated our password. And if you look at it, if I'm just want to show you the code again, what's the great part about this code, about Python code, is all of this is very easily understandable. Now, even if you're a beginner looking at this code, you see that we've just generated some lists and we're generating a password by randomly choosing some alphabets or some numbers from that list. That's all we are doing. Once we've generated that, we're making sure we're adding the numbers again and again, adding the passwords again and again, so that it meets our minimum criteria of the length. That's what we're doing over here. But if you look at it, it's not really that difficult. In fact, this we have made only 5 characters choosing. We could have chosen up to like 15 characters, 26 characters, similarly for the upper characters. So all that I encourage you to do when you are going for a website or some other place and you have to give a password, generate on your own very strong password, generate a very random strong password and store it somewhere. You can use that for any of your online accounts. And the best part is you will feel so happy because you made your own password generator. So what you can do is you yourselves can try out to make a password generator by going to edist.com. So what you could do is just log on to the link below. That's bit.ly/edist_python. Click apply now. So once you click apply now, you will end up in this page. Let me just show you that again. You'll end up on this page. And once you enter on this page, this first module is completely free for you to do. Try out this one free module and you'll be able to do this password generator. So this password generator is free, open for everybody. Try doing this password generator. It's a really fun exercise. Go ahead and do try out this by yourself, right? So that's it from our side. Now we're going to open it up for questions. So if anybody has any questions, please post it on the chat on the right side and we'll be more than happy to help you out with those questions. So I'll just wait for my team to help us with any questions that we might have. And we'll just check the chat as well, whether we have any questions. And all right. Okay.
Right. Yep. Lot of questions today again. Right. The first question as always is, what is the minimum required syllabus to cover before we start attending interviews?
Okay, so a very good question has been asked by somebody. That is, what is the minimum required syllabus I should cover before actually attending an interview? And so I'm glad you asked this because this is the exact syllabus that we cover on the Edist platform. Whenever you are going for an interview, you should be prepared with these topics. And let me just open that up for you and show you. Basically speaking, any interview or any job, any fresher job today requires you to do about 3 things. All right. Number one, your basics should be really, really good. Number two, your advanced concepts like object-oriented programming, data structures should be really good. And then three is you should have a good project in a framework. So just to give you an example, this is the Python course that we run. Just pulling that up. So this is the Python course that we run, which is a combination of the Python introduction plus the Python advanced. And plus what we also do in this is after this, we cover a framework, a project. So if you do a Python introduction, we cover all of the basics of Python, that is the fundamentals of Python that is covered. This is required for any of the interviews that you attend. The first round, the coding round, will always be this round, that is the Python introduction part. The second round is going to be all about the technical interviews, which are mentioned in the Python advanced concepts. So you're going to have things like OOP, data structures, advanced data structures, and so on. So once you do these things, you are able to clear the technical interview. Then you also need to have a good project or a framework, and that will really help you in getting a job.
So typically, how long does it take for us to learn basic Python and then advanced Python?
So very good question. How long will it take me to learn both basics and advanced? I'm a beginner. I don't know much. I have done a little bit of C programming in my first year, but after that, I have not really touched programming. How long will it take me to learn Python? Well, the thing about Python is that one, you have to spend a lot of time on the logic. You won't have to spend so much time on the syntax because the syntax is very easy. It's almost like English. So Python takes a little bit faster, like you can learn it faster. Generally speaking, the Python intro plus advanced, you can finish roughly in about 2 months or so. So within 2 months, you can be in a good level of both intro plus advanced. And then after that, picking up a framework is just about 1 more month or so. So all of this Python intro, advanced and a framework, you can, you know, probably learn it in about, let's say 3 months or so. And you will be able to learn, you will be able to be job ready or should I say employable. That is when you go for an interview, you should be able to crack that interview. But it requires good 3-3.5 months effort from your side to sit, learn programming and practice it thoroughly.
A couple of questions. They are non-computer science people. Is Python a good choice of language to start, or should they stick with C++?
All right, so good question from somebody who's from a core background. They ask that, what should I, if I'm from a core background, if I'm like ECS, ECE, EEE, mechanical, is Python really a good choice to learn, or should I, you know, stick to C++? So number one thing is the entire industry is moving on to Python. That's why all of the new tools themselves are being built in Python. The biggest example is something like machine learning and AI. These tools were built in Python because everybody knew Python. Similarly with data science, all of these tools people did in Python because everybody else was already doing Python. So all of your new tools, whether it's, you know, you're at ECE, EEE, whichever, they're going to start being done on Python more and more. Learning Python will give you a gateway into any of these fields, any of the software roles that you are going to go into. So Python is a great choice, especially for core students, because it's easier to learn, much easier to learn than C and C++.
Couple of questions there asked by two different people. I'll just frame it. What are frameworks in a language like Python? Number two, which of the framework is better? Is it Flask a better one or a Django?
Okay, very good. So somebody's asking what exactly is a framework, and you know, what do you mean by a framework? So a framework is nothing but it is a collection of things or collection of libraries that are used to help you do or achieve a task in a better way. Just to give an example, as I was saying earlier about the kind of careers that we have in Python. So these are the kind of careers that we mentioned. Each of these careers in Python require a different framework that you should be good at. So for example, for web development, there are frameworks like Flask and Django. For machine learning, there are, you know, frameworks like TensorFlow. For game development, data analytics, they have their own frameworks. So it's like saying you already learned Python, but you need to specialize in one particular thing. So if you want to specialize in web development, a good framework is Flask and Django. You can choose Flask, you can choose Django depending on your needs. Similarly, if you want to specialize in machine learning, a good framework to learn is TensorFlow, and so on. So each of these frameworks help you achieve a specific target. For us, we see that most of the jobs regarding Python are in web development, especially for freshers. And that is why in our special course where we cover advanced frameworks as well, we cover both Flask and Django. We give an introduction to both Flask and Django. And really, if you learn Flask, you can move on to Django. If you learn Django, you can move on to Flask. So we make it easier for you to learn these frameworks and actually implement them and have a project in them.
A couple of questions from students who are still in the second and third year of engineering.
Right. Okay.
When is the right time to start learning?
Okay. So a good question from some students who are in the second and third year, and they're asking, what is really the right time to actually start learning programming? I mean, and I'll tell you this, like a lot of you, I'm sure, must have heard from your seniors saying that, you know what, it's not really necessary right now to pick up programming. You can come to your third year or your fourth year and, you know, you can pick up. Well, my answer to you is you really have to choose what your objective in your career is. Do you just want to, you know, come to the fourth year, maybe get a job, and if you don't get a job in fourth year, then you're in real trouble? Or if you start preparing right now from second and third year, you will get really good at a programming language, you will get good at a framework, and you can actually apply for higher level companies. Just to give you an example of few EDIST alumni who've already been there, just to give you an example of one of our alumni who started coding when he was in fourth year. Right now, he's got a job for 6 lakhs per annum at a company called EPAM. That's possible if you start coding earlier. We have other students who've got jobs at 7-8 lakhs, and they've started coding in their second year. So second year, third year is the best time to start coding. That is a time where you can learn and then also apply for advanced companies later on.
You told this is a mini project using Python. Are these the kind of projects which will be asked in interviews?
So a very good question. This is a mini project using Python. Can I show this mini project to interviewers as will this be good enough in an interview? So the answer is just this will not be enough. But as I told you, if you keep building up on top of this, let's say you make this project, this password, making sure that it will, even if you generate 1 million passwords, there's never going to be a repeat password. Or you're going to make sure that to crack this password, it's going to take about 1 million tries. Then you know it's a very good project and you should be able to explain that to an interviewer. But even that, whatever I've just mentioned, all of that still builds from the basic blocks that we've covered today. So just using the simple concepts that we've covered today, you can generate all of those really fancy passwords, and that would really qualify as a good project for your interview.
What are some of the other webinars which we can expect from Elist?
All right, so we are doing, somebody is asking about what are the other webinars that we can expect from Edist and what are the upcoming ones. So we are doing a special Python series right now. We want to help all of you who have not got a job or still wanting to learn programming in your college to learn Python and learn it in a fun way. What we're doing is every day we are going to cover a different project. So today we covered how to do a password generator. Tomorrow we're going to cover how you can actually calculate EMI using Python. We are also going to do how you can convert time zones. So if I give you a time zone of India, how do I find out what's the time in Chicago and what's the weather in Chicago right now? How do we do that? So all of this can be done in Python using some very simple maths, not a lot of programming required, just simple programming stuff required. So I'll be showing you some very simple mini projects in the upcoming webinars. So do subscribe to the channel to know about all of the projects that are going to come up.
Two last questions. When we hear these webinars, where do we go and practice? And is that practice enough?
All right, so you are hearing all of these webinars and you're wondering where should you practice and is the practice enough, first of all. So everything that we cover in a webinar is not just for you to see. We want you to go and implement it. And the way to implement that is just to go to the Edist platform, free of cost. There is any of the stuff we cover in a webinar will already be mentioned on the platform. The way you do that is, if I'll just show it to you again, when you log on to Edist.com, when you get onto Edist.com, this is what shows. So just showing you, this is what will show. It's just on Edist.com. You just need to go to this Python programming intro plus advanced, click start now. So when I click start now over here, I'm going to get a video about, you know, what is it this course is about and, you know, the information about the course. When you click apply now, it will ask you to sign in by Google or Facebook. Sign in with either of those accounts that you want. So I'm just going to, you know, choose Google right now and just, you know, log in. And, you know, once you log in over here, you'll see a course like this. So you'll see all of the courses and here is where your password generator is. So that's what you'll end up seeing. And yeah, so anything that we cover on the Edist platform is in the webinar is already covered on the Edist platform. So you can just go try it out. Today's password generator is mentioned over here. One second. Yeah, so this is, once you click apply now, this is what it will look like for you. This one module will look completely free. Once you click this module, you can see about 22 people have already completed this module. You'll see this password generator over here. And you can click this password generator and actually try out the password generator today and get about 50 points.
One last question. We are out of time, but Divyansh is asking, I'll in fact combine two questions. Divyansh is asking how to clear or qualify Hack with Infy. There are other people asking Hack with Infy, Code Vita, Ninja, the Wipro's NQT. How does Python help in clearing all of these things?
Okay, very good. So I see a lot of students are very excited to attend contests like Hack with Infy or TCS or Code Vita. You know, all of these amazing contests that have been happening since the last 2-3 years. And it's a brilliant opportunity for you to get a job. How does Python help you out over here? Well, the best part is Python is accepted as a programming language in all of these coding contests. So you take Code Vita, you take Hack with Infy, you take InfyTQ, all of these are Python based. In fact, InfyTQ is only Python based. You can't even do it in Java or C++. So learning Python gives you a real advantage for going to any of these coding contests, including any of the companies that will come to your campus. So let it be, you know, AMCAD doing a test for other companies, let it be, you know, on campus or off campus drives. Every company is taking Python as a consideration. So learning Python will help you clear on-campus, off-campus drives. It will also help you clear any of the coding contests because Python is an accepted language in all of the coding contests. Right. So with that, we wrap up for today. Thanks everybody for the great turnout. Really happy to see all of you. Please share this knowledge with your friends. So do share this video, help them also do this cool mini project. Imagine you go into an interview and have a password generator. It's such a good thing to show to an interviewer. So do share it with your friends. Please subscribe to this channel so that you will get the notification of every other project that we are going to do. We are going to do some really cool projects on Python. And that's a cool part about Python. You can do some really really fun and exciting projects in it. So subscribe, share, and sign up for the Edist Python course where you can implement this Python password generator yourself. All the best, everybody. Thank you so much for joining, and see you all next time.